Okay, and now you know immediately how we're going to form our basis functions in 3D, right? We've already written them out previously. We've written out our trilinears. It's straightforward to just write out the formula now, right? So we say likewise. In 3D, right? In this case, we have number of nodes in the element equals number of nodes in 1D cube. Okay, so it was that when we constructed the trilinears, we observed that we had 8 degrees of freedom, right? 2 cube. Okay, so it is the same approach, right? So we have so you recall that the trilinears, right? The trilinears were right. For the trilinears, we had this sort of an element. In the biunit domain. Okay. Right. So in the setting, once again, we simply have Na C1 C2 C3 equals N tilde B C1 N tilde C C2 N tilde D C3, right, where B, C, and D belong to one up to number of nodes in the 1D element, right, and A belongs to the set 1 up to number of nodes in the element. Okay, so it's completely straightforward to see how we construct these. And then it's just a matter of figuring out the numbering. Okay, the numbering in this case, of course, is A equals 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, if we were to go to dry quadratics, there are various numbering systems that are used depending upon the particular preference of the people constructing these functions. But typically for tri quadratics, let me show you what sort of numbering is followed. Okay, so I'm going to draw that again, and I'll try to draw it a little bigger. Okay, so these would be our vertex nodes or vertex degrees of freedom. I'll switch to a different color to draw the mid-side nodes. The mid-side nodes would be these ones. Okay, and then there are the mid-face nodes, which are these. Let me see, 1, 2, 3. I need to have one on this face, and that sort of does it. Okay, there's one final, which is a mid body node, for which I'm sort of running out of colors here, but maybe I'll use black. Okay, this one would be in the very center, the centroid of the cube. All right, so the numbering that's typically used here is the following. Often the vertex nodes are numbered 1 through 8. And then the mid-side nodes are numbered next. I began numbering the some of the mid-face nodes instead. So I had 9, 10, 11, 12. I need to erase this one as well. Okay, 9, 10, 11, 12, okay. 9, 10, 11, 12. Actually, maybe I won't use that numbering system. What I'm going to do instead is this one. Sorry. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, so I have 1, 2, 3, 4. Sorry. One, two, three, four, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and then continuing on, we get 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, and we get the mid-body node, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, and 27 ends with the mid-face node on the top. Okay, so there we have it, and other numbering schemes are possible. Now, what one has to do in constructing these triquadratic basis functions is pick any one of these nodes, right? So let's suppose we decide to construct the basis functions for node 5, right, or degree of freedom 5. Okay, all we have to do here is observe that that basis function could be constructed from the n tildes by choosing for the xi1 direction something, something else for the xi2 direction, and something for the C3 direction. What I'll do now is to come back and actually say which ones. All right, so let's look at this, right? The C1 direction is this. That is the C2 direction, and that is C3. All right, so that's node, that is degree of freedom 5, right? That's the basis function we want to construct. So in the C1 direction, right, when we look back at the way we number the basis functions in 1D, in the C1 direction, we are using the N2, N2 tilde, okay? In the C2 direction, we are using N1 tilde. And in the C3 direction, also we're using N1 tilde, okay? So that's the sort of check one would make in writing out these basis functions in three dimensions, and of course the same approach would be used in 2D as well, okay? The nice thing to observe is that it is just this very simple tensor product formula that one has to use, right? So we construct these basis functions first in 1D and then generalize them to two and three dimensions. Of course, this works as long as we are looking at elements that exploit this tensor product construction, right? So it is indeed that when one can go from simple 1D segments in 1D to quadrilaterals in 2D and hexahedra in 3D, okay? In a couple of segments, we will look at a variation on that idea. All right, but we'll end this segment here.